Hi, it's Gadget UK here again. This time I'm looking at some things that have been sent by a friend of mine, actually, Colin. It's worth noting that Colin's going through a tough time just now, actually, and I've been upset myself all week. Colin's son's actually been rushed into hospital this week with leukemia. I seriously hope, Nathan gets better soon. He's having a really tough time, but I need to take my mind off things. So in the meantime, I thought I'd have a look at this box of things that Colin sent me, and I'll be sorting out some money for all of this stuff, because there's a lot of stuff he sent me, and I'll be covering it over a number of videos. All of this equipment and components and things here belong to the late Alison Challis. Alison was Colin's partner. I've mentioned Alison before. She's the reason why this channel exists. She was like an Atari electronics expert, really, I guess you could call her. She sort of frequented the Atari Forum and did repairs, upgrades, mods, all that sort of stuff for a number of years, and I think she was like a moderator on that forum or something. She was certainly a major contributor, and she created the PEST and Atari ST PS2 to Atari mouse adapter. So we'll start with this. This is one of the first components, that's the first tools, just some of the smaller tools he sent me in the box here. And I've turned the screw out. You can see a bit of corrosion there. I just removed the battery. As you can see, it's leaked. It's sad, really, because obviously she would have put that battery in there, and then after she died, it's been left for 3 or 4 years, and there's some corrosion saying is that that battery's leaked. But I think that's all that is. I think if we get a working battery, if I'll just try that, get a working Duracell. Well, this Duracell looks a bit corroded, actually. Let's give that a try. In fact, no, that is the corroded battery. That's come out of something else. Let me just find another battery. Hang on. So I've got a battery in there now. Just need to get some probes in, I think, because I'm not sure how you tell whether that's working or not. So I've got the batteries in here. I've noticed a problem on this, and maybe Alison never noticed it, I don't know. Can you see that resistor down there? We've got a burnt out resistor. So certainly one of the modes in this has been affected by the damage there of that resistor. So I'll swap that out later, I think. I'll measure it in the first instance, just make sure it's not open circuit. But and that's going to have nothing to do with the battery. They're just totally separate things. Assuming the fuses. Okay, if I now think about it, the fuse might have gone. Let's just test that fuse. No, the fuse is alright. So I think that meter's probably okay for some of the modes. It might be, that resistor might be something to do with the current test mode, perhaps. I'll experiment a bit more later once I find some probes or something for this, but right now there's not a lot more I can do with that one. But yeah, you can see I do have some corrosions coming up there, so I'll sort that out later. But the main thing I wanted to show in this video is this, which is a Velleman instruments. Is there a model number on this somewhere? Yeah, HPS10. So it's a personal, handheld oscilloscope, and it's rated. Does it send the back? I think it goes up to 10 megahertz or something like that. It might be 20 megahertz, I'm not sure. It's quite low. I think it's 10 megahertz, to be fair. 600 volt category 2. Battery type, yeah, AA. And you can see the problem here again. I've removed the AA batteries and cleaned these up a bit, but we've got some corrosion. And after putting a set of new batteries in here, it doesn't power on. You get the batteries in there, you press this button here, the screen's supposed to come on. It doesn't power on. In fact, I'll just see if I can just demonstrate that now. If I just get these batteries in there, not mix up this leaked one. Now, one or two of these are rechargeable nickel metal hydride batteries, I think. So they might not quite provide quite enough voltage anyway. So, as you can see, it won't come on. Yeah, I'm pressing the power button there, it won't come on even if I rotate them around. Yesterday at one point I did manage to get the screen to do something, but it was like, looked like corrupted lines and things on the display, I couldn't get it to come on. So it's going to be a tear down this, I think. So yeah, I'll get the screws out. We've got two screws in the battery bay here, And then two screws at the top here. So I'll get those out and we'll have a look to see what's going on around this area here, see if the corrosion's done any damage. So I've got the screws out there, and I think we're probably very lucky actually, because the design here, you can see, means that the battery bay seems completely isolated from the main board. There's a bit of corrosion just there, can you see? So if we're really unlucky, we might have a tiny bit of corrosion on the underside, or you know, top side of here, but it's, you know, it's just on that screw there, I think. So I think this is going to be okay. You know, the board looks in remarkable condition, really, all things considered. So I mean, now I've got this like this, I'll perhaps let's have a look at this. Yeah, I'll perhaps just, you know, get the wire brush and stuff and a bit of sandpaper and stuff onto these contacts and things, try and clean them all up. Maybe retry it. I don't even think I'm going to take the board out at this stage, because I'll just inspect it really closely, just make sure it's okay. Make sure we've not got any corrosion on that chip. But I think it's just leaked onto there. I don't think it's going to be a huge problem. So the way I'm approaching this is just bending these tabs up, as you can see, you know, I've just lifted these two here, it's pretty easy to do, and then with a bit of manipulation, I should, as you can see there, be able to get that piece out, which now means, like I say, I can just put that on the table somewhere and give it a really good scrubbing, with a wire brush, some sandpaper, some IPA, maybe some vinegar. Yeah, certainly neutralise it at the end there with some IPA, but you know, the main thing is, like I say, I can work on it a lot easier. The springs are okay, I think it's just these, simply these contacts here. You know, you've had a chemical reaction go on there, but that is the nice thing, can you see? You just bend them out really gently. I mean, obviously, if these were really corroded, those would break off, so you'd have to replace them with something that. And of course, there's other things you could perhaps do. You could perhaps put another battery in this battery bay. Yeah, AA's might not be such a good thing really for something like this in the modern day, but yeah, we'll do these ones last, I think. You know, it's a similar thing with these. You can just bend these up. Might need to desolder the wires there in order to get the final bits out, but you know, I can then also clean inside the cavity here as well. I might just get the bottom of that into the sink and give it a really good scrubbing, you know, get the brush on there and stuff. Yeah, so just a bit of this really. And of course, you know, you can get sort of specialist rust removal chemicals, and I do have some, so might have a go at sticking a little bit of that on there as well, actually. But yeah, I think we should be okay with a wire brush and then a bit of sandpaper. Just get all the main corrosion off, as you can see there, and go over it with the sandpaper. Maybe even use a bit of WD-40 because it's a solvent, and you can find that stuff makes a massive difference cleaning things like this up. Actually, when you've got corrosion. But yeah, you can see that tab now, it's not looking bad apart from the fact it's just a bit dulled. So I'm finally here, just a bit of sandpaper just to go over there and try and remove that little bit of corrosion that's still sort of embedded in the surface. But yeah, that's not too bad actually, it's not too bad at all. So a quick progress update here, got those two still to clean up there, that's the positive terminal, it's not too bad, that's one of the worst ones actually. You can see the ones over here that I have already cleaned up. I will get a bit of IPA, you know, clean these up with some IPA before I put them back in. If you use WD-40 or some other solvent or something to clean these, obviously it's important you know, use IPA to clean any oils and things like that, contaminants off them, before you put them back in, otherwise you're not going to get a good connection. So now I've got all of the bits out of here, you can see I just desoldered the wires there, so the plus is the flat one. Like that. So it should be easy to put those back in. But yeah, I'm going to just get the bottom half of this into the sink now and just scrub it with a scrubbing brush and some soap and water, you know, clear out the cavities. So yeah, you can see I had a little go with the cotton buds there, but you know, you can get it all out, so it's easy to use, it's easier to, let's say, put it in the sink really and give it a scrub. So there you go, it's about as clean as it's going to get. It's been in the sink, you can see, you know, it's the plastic's sort of got like a white sort of colouring where it's, you know, it's discoloured the plastic, but all of the corrosion has come out of there, so I can get the contacts, you know, the battery terminals in there and give it a try. So all reassembled there now. There's still a bit of corrosion there and the main screw that goes through, but yeah, I'll see what I can do about that in a minute. But yeah, we'll clip it back together and see whether it works or not. So I've got the batteries in here now. I've hit the power button, you can see that's working sweet. Yeah, and I've touched the probe. You can see we're getting something on the screen there. So yeah, it's not very easy to see. It's got a screen protector on there. I noticed Ali stuck a screen protector on, but I'll put a new one on probably. I'll probably remove that, put a new one on. And just clean it up a bit. It's a bit dirty. You can see it's scuffed and stuff down here. You know, it has got a low maximum frequency that this will, I don't know what you call it, is it bandwidth or whatever? You know, it'll go up to, I think, 10 megahertz. But for things like, you know, C64, Spectrums, NES, Famicom, etc., you know, it's going to be fine for that sort of thing, so this is really useful. Even the possibly the Atari ST, yeah, it should be alright. Initially, I valued this at around £200, I think, when I first saw it, but looking on eBay, you can get this between £80 and £100. So, I mean, I'll probably end up giving Colin a couple of hundred quid anyway, at least, because there is a load of components and things like this. I'll show you in another video. You can see them, some of them strewn around here, there's an awful lot of stuff. I'll be splitting some of this up and sending some of it to Chris Swinson, I think. I'm sure Ali would have wanted him to have a chunk of these components, actually. You know, I'll pretty much just split them down the middle or something like that, because I'm never going to use them all. But this is brilliant. I'm sure Ali loved using this. Just the portability, you know, of it, really. It's pretty lightweight. It saves you getting out the you know, your main scope and stuff. Although, you know, when you've got a desk set up and stuff, it's probably not a problem, but you know, the portability is what makes this fantastic. All cleaned up and reassembled. I will put a new screen protector on there, like I say, at some point. I think the screen's probably largely scratch-free. It's just the protector's got some scratches and marks and stuff on it. And I could get a bit of plastic polish onto here still in places. But you can see down here, you know, this is it's like being grazed, I think. I don't think plastic cleaner's going to help with that. But it's cleaner than it was. And the main thing is it works. You know, the battery's... battery bay there is fixed. I'm going to treasure this. I mean, obviously, like I say, I'll be sending Colin some money for this, so it's not like he's sending me for free. I think Ali would want him to have some money for this. And like I say, I initially valued it a couple of £100, and I'll end up paying him a couple of £100, I think. But you can buy one of these if you want one of these. You can buy these on eBay for about 80 to £100, like I say. And I think, like I said at the beginning of the video, there's an SE version. I think there's like a backlight button or something here, and you know, it'll give like a blue backlight. Could always do a mod to this, but to be honest, I'd rather keep it as it is. So I hope Nathan starts to feel better over the next few days as he starts his treatment and stuff. You know, like I say, we are all really worried about Nathan at the moment. It's really shit. It is. He's such a nice guy. And it's just come from nowhere. You know, one minute it was okay, and then the next minute it's rushed into hospital. It's shit. So life sometimes like that. But yeah, we've just got to just you know, try and be positive and look forward to him recovering, really. You know, and many thanks to Colin for sending this, and ultimately Alison. You know, it's much appreciated. It's a fantastic bit of kit. Yeah, so check your batteries in your devices. I think the problem with this is it uses the power in standby. Even when it's switched off, these batteries drain really quickly. So I think what I might do is, you know, you can, with things like that, just get yourself a piece of clear plastic, a plastic tab, and shove it either in the positive or the negative side of the battery bay, you know, whilst the batteries are in there, and then just screw your flap back on. So while you're not using it, the batteries are sat there inside it, you know, because you might not want to take them out, but they're not going to be draining. So it's going to take me some time to get used to using this, I think. You can see, I think it's on AC at the moment. And you can see, I'm just looking at a clock here on a Famicom at the moment. Put it on DC. Let's just change the display mode here. Let's put it in dynamic. I think that it updates as it's going along. And the way you use the scope, let's say some of the buttons are going to be held down for a period of time. So believe it or not, that is a clock. Now, I did have a much cleaner... signal there a minute ago. I'm not sure what I did to do it, actually. Let me try pressing auto again. Yeah, strangely enough, it looks better in AC coupling mode, but it jumps all over the bloody place. Yeah, it is working. It's just not great, really. It's just useful for basic things. Anyway, I thought you'd find that interesting. Thanks for watching. I'll see you soon.